मुकुंद जोशी फ्रॉम योगेश्वरी महाविद्यालय अम्बदोई. डियर स्टूडेंट्स, इन द लास्ट पीरियड वी हैव स्टडीड अबाउट द इंटरवल्स ऑफ लाइफ इयर्स. इन दिस पीरियड वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट द फिनोमेना डिफ्रैक्शन ऑफ लाइट. अकॉर्डिंग टू नेचर, लाइट इज क्लासिफाइड इनटू टू कैटेगरीज. First one is called as the particle nature and second is called as its wave nature. Raman effect, Compton effect, photoelectric effect are the examples of particle nature of light, whereas rectilinear propagation of light, reflection of light, refraction of light, interference, diffraction, polarization, etc. are the examples of wave nature of light. Let us study about the wave nature of light, that is diffraction. We know that light travels in a straight line path. This is called as the rectilinear phenomenon of light. When an opaque object is placed between source of monochromatic light and screen, then a sharp shadow of that object is obtained on the screen. This effect shows that light travels along a straight line path. But if the size of that object or obstacle or an aperture is comparable to the wavelength of incident light, then there is a departure of light from its straight line path and light enters into the geometrical shadow of that object. I repeat once again this statement. If the size of the object or aperture or obstacle is comparable to the wavelength of monochromatic light, then there is a departure of light, there is a bending of light from its straight line path and light enters into the geometrical shadow of that object. This is the key idea of diffraction of light. If the size of the object is large as compared to the wavelength of incident light, then there is a small bending. If the size of the object is small as compared to the wavelength of incident light, then there is a large bending. Hence, we can define diffraction of light as the phenomenon of bending of light and spreading of light into geometrical shadow of that object. I repeat once again, the bending of light around the corners of the obstacle or aperture and spreading of light waves into the geometrical shadow of that object is called as diffraction of light. Let us study the two classes of diffraction. The first class is called as the Fresnel diffraction and the second class or second type is called as Fraunhofer diffraction. What is the difference between these two classes or these two types of diffraction? There are three points of which these classes are defined. First point is definition or condition. In Fresnel diffraction, source of monochromatic light or screen are at finite distance. Are at finite distance from the obstacle or aperture or from diffracting system. In Fraunhofer type diffraction, source of monochromatic light and screen are at infinite distance. From the diffracting system, that is aperture or an obstacle. This is the basic difference. Second point is about lenses. In Fresnel type diffraction, no lenses are used to make the rays parallel or convergent. No lenses are used. In Fresnel type diffraction, no lenses are used to make the rays parallel or convergent. But in Fraunhofer type diffraction, two lenses are used. One to make the rays parallel before falling on the diffracting system, and another to make the rays convergent or focus on the screen after diffraction. This is the second difference. And last difference is about the incident wavefront. In Fresnel type diffraction, the incident wavefront is always either spherical or cylindrical. Note down this point. In this Fresnel type diffraction, the incident wavefront is always either spherical wavefront or cylindrical wavefront. But in Fraunhofer type diffraction, the incident wavefront is always a plane wavefront. These are the three major differences between the Fresnel diffraction and Fraunhofer diffraction. Now, let us study the next one. The next one is Fraunhofer diffraction due to a single screen. When this experiment is performed, then the diffraction pattern formed due to a single slit consists of a central bright maximum or principal maximum and alternate bright and dark bands of decreasing intensity on both sides of central maximum. I am taking about the diffraction pattern formed due to single slit. Diffraction pattern formed due to Fraunhofer diffraction due to single slit consists of a central bright band or a principal maximum along with the alternate bright and dark bands of decreasing intensity on both sides of central maximum. For nth secondary maxima, just like in interference we say that what is the condition for constructive interference and what is the condition for path difference or for destructive interference. Similarly, we define the formula for n secondary maxima, that is path difference. Path difference is always equal to thrice n plus 1 into lambda by 2, which is equal to a into sine theta, where a is the slit width, n is the number of bright band, lambda is the wavelength of incident light, and this n is equal to plus or minus 1, comma plus or minus 2, comma plus or minus 3, dot dot etc. Where plus sign indicates the bands on the right side of the central maximum, and minus sign indicates the bands or fringes on the left side of the central maximum. Here, theta n is the angular position of the nth bright maximum. In the same way, there is a formula for nth secondary minima. Nth secondary minima. This formula gives the path inference is equal to n lambda, which is equal to a into sine theta n. In this formula also, n is the fringe number, band number in the of this secondary minima. Lambda is the wavelength of incident monochromatic light. A is the slit width, and theta n is the angular position of the nth secondary minima. These are the conditions for secondary maxima and secondary minima. We are going to face the CET exam. Therefore, I have written these direct for you. Now, the pattern of the defect, pattern of diffraction, or intensity variation curve, intensity variation curve, that is diffraction pattern, due to single slit. How it look like? This is the intensity variation curve. On y-axis, we take the intensity. This is the position of central maximum. And the pattern is like this. The important point to be noted here is that there is no touch of secondary minima on the x-axis. There is slight, these curves are flat above the x-axis. This point corresponds to lambda, path inference lambda. This point corresponds to path inference 2 lambda. This point corresponds to path inference 3 lambda. This is minus lambda. This is minus 2 lambda, and so on. This is the diffraction pattern due to a single slit. Note that diffraction pattern consists of, this is the central maxima or principal maxima. In diffraction pattern, there is only one central maxima or principal maxima, and on both sides of that central maxima, there are secondary minima, and these are the secondary maxima. And on x-axis, we have taken the path inference, or y-axis, we have taken the intensity. Now, on this diffraction pattern, there are some questions asked on the CET exam are that, number one, what is the linear width of central maximum and that linear width of the central maximum is given by W is equal to twice lambda d divided by a, or which is equal to twice lambda f divided by a. This W indicates the width of the central maximum, that is this width. Lambda is the wavelength of monochromatic light. Capital T is the distance between diffracting system and screen, slit and screen. Small a is the slit width, and f is the focal length of convex lens used in the diffraction experiment. Second formula is that linear width of secondary maxima. It is also denoted by W, but word is to be noted that width of secondary maxima and width of central maxima. This is the width of central maxima, and this is the width of secondary maxima. This is the width of secondary maxima, and this width is given by only lambda d upon a or lambda f upon a. Only neglect 2. Therefore, here also, W is the width of secondary maxima, lambda is the wavelength of incident monochromatic light, capital T is the distance between slit and screen, and f is the focal length of convex lens. In the similar way, we also take the two formulae which are frequently asked in the CET exam. Examples are also asked on that formula. That formula is, what is the angular width? Now we have taken the linear width. Here, angular width of central maxima is given by twice theta. Angular width of this central maxima is equal to twice lambda upon a. Note that angular width of central maxima is equal to twice lambda upon a, and in similar manner, we can define the angular width of secondary maxima as theta is equal to lambda divided by a. These are the formulae of which MCQ is frequently asked. Therefore, take down this formula and we will proceed for next time. That is resolving power. That is a resolving power. This resolving power is of optical instrument. The resolution means the separation, and the resolving power means the ability of an optical instrument to separate or to resolve the images of two closed point objects. I repeat once again, resolving power of an optical instrument is the ability to separate or resolve the images of the two closed point objects. This is the definition of resolving power. The second term required for this concept is that the limit of resolution. The limit of resolution is the minimum linear separation or the minimum angular separation between the two closed objects. Let us repeat this. Limit of resolution is the minimum either linear or angular separation between the two closed objects at which they are appear to be just resolved. This is the limit of resolution. Note that resolution is the separation. Limit of resolution is the minimum separation. Now, what is the relation between these two terms? These two relation is that the resolving power is the reciprocal of limit of resolution. Resolving power is the reciprocal of limit of resolution. That is, resolving power is equal to 1 divided by limit of resolution. If these terms are clear, then we proceed further. That is, Rayleigh's criterion. That is, Rayleigh's criterion for resolution. Criteria declares whether the two images are just resolved or not. If the two images are said to be just resolved, then what is the criteria? That criteria is given by the Rayleigh. According to this criterion, the images of the two closed objects are said to be just resolved if central maximum of first diffraction pattern exactly coincides on the first minimum of other diffraction pattern. I will repeat this statement of criterion once again. The two images of the two closed objects are said to be just resolved if the central maximum of first diffraction pattern falls out, the exactly falls out the first minimum of other diffraction pattern. This is the criterion for resolution. I will draw the diagram for clear concept that if this is the central maximum of first diffraction pattern, this is the central maximum of second diffraction pattern. Previously I have drawn this diagram for single diffraction pattern. The same diagrams for two closed objects I am going to draw. This is the diffraction pattern for second image. This is the diffraction pattern of first image. And note down, if the central maximum of one diffraction pattern exactly falls out the central maximum of other diffraction pattern. Note that this is the central maximum of second diffraction pattern that exactly coincides its first minimum on the first central maximum of first diffraction pattern. In the same way, if the central maximum of first diffraction pattern exactly coincides its first minimum with the central maximum of second diffraction pattern, this is the, then the two images are said to be just resolved. According to Rayleigh's criterion, the image
images of the two closed objects are said to be just result if the diffraction pattern, central maximum of first diffraction pattern and its first minimum coincides with the principal maximum of second diffraction pattern and vice versa. This is the condition of, this is the criterion of resolution according to Rayleigh's criterion. Now, I define the two terms. That is, first, if alpha and theta. I am going to define the two terms. If alpha is the angle between two closed objects, these are the two closed objects. If this is the alpha, if alpha is the angle between the two closed objects or between the two center maxima, and theta is the angle between center maximum and its first minimum. This is the theta. Theta is the angle between center maximum and its first minimum. And alpha is the angle between the two objects or angle between the two principal maximum. Then the first condition is that if alpha is greater than theta, second condition is that if alpha is equal to theta, and last condition is that if alpha is less than theta. Note that if alpha is greater than theta, then the two images are already resolved, completely resolved. If alpha is equal to theta, that is, the angular separation between the central maximum and its first minimum is always equal to angle between the two central maxima, then the two images are said to be just resolved. And last condition is that if alpha is greater than theta, that is, if the positions of the two center maxima is less than the center maximum and its first minimum, then the two images are not resolved. For resolution, we always require this condition. We are not dealing with this and this, but we require alpha is equal to theta for just resolution. Rayleigh's criterion is related for just resolution, not complete resolution and not for unresolution. On this basis, there are two optical instruments. Given this level, one is microscope and second is telescope. One is microscope and second is telescope. The basic difference that everyone knows is that microscope is used for seeing the near objects and telescope is used to observe the objects which are at very large distance from its object. And let us calculate the resolving power of microscope and telescope. If the objects which are observed through microscope are very near to its objective,
then we can determine the distance between them. Therefore, limit of resolution in case of microscope is nothing but the minimum separation, minimum distance between the two closed objects. In the same manner, we can define the limit of resolution of telescope. In through telescope, we are going to observe the objects which are at a very large distance. We cannot measure the separation or distance between that two objects. In that case, we define the angle between them. Therefore, in case of telescope, limit of resolution is nothing but the angular separation between that two closed objects. Note that limit of resolution for microscope is nothing but the minimum linear separation, and in case of telescope, limit of resolution is nothing but the minimum angular separation. The next point is that what is the Rayleigh criteria for resolution of two closed objects through microscope, observed through microscope? According to Rayleigh's criteria, these two closed objects are said to be just resolved if the central maximum of one falls on the first minimum of other diffraction pattern. And this condition is satisfied if the path difference, note that the two images are said to be just resolved if the central maximum of one falls on the first minimum. Therefore, we do not write the path difference is equal to L lambda, that is 1 lambda. First minimum, 1 lambda is equal to 2d sin theta. 2d sin theta. Or we say that 2d sin alpha. This is the formula. Therefore, equating these two terms, we get d is equal to lambda divided by 2 sin alpha. This is the formula for limit of resolution. This formula, d is equal to lambda divided by 2 sin alpha, is generally used for self-luminous objects. This formula is applicable for the self-luminous objects. But limit of resolution for externally illuminated object is given by lambda is equal to twice mu into sin alpha. Twice mu into sin alpha. This is the formula for limit of resolution through microscope. Limit of resolution of microscope for externally illuminated objects. In this formula, lambda is the wavelength of incident monochromatic light. Mu is the refractive index of medium in which that objects are placed. Mu sin alpha. That mu sin alpha is called as the numerical aperture. Mu sin alpha is called as the numerical aperture of the object. Let us define the same for telescope. For telescope, path difference is equal to, note that in Rayleigh's criterion, the condition is given for first minima. Therefore, path difference is equal to 1 lambda. Path difference is equal to 1 lambda, which is equal to A sin theta n corresponds to 1. This is the formula according to Rayleigh's criteria. The path difference is equal to lambda is equal to A sin theta, but if theta is small, then for small theta, sin theta is equal to theta, therefore formula becomes A sin theta is equal to A theta, which is equal to lambda. I have to calculate d theta, therefore in this case, we write as per formula A sin d theta, therefore A d theta. If d theta is small, then sin theta is equal to d theta. Therefore, a into d theta is equal to lambda. Therefore, d theta is equal to lambda upon a. In this formula also, a is the slit width and lambda is the wavelength of incident monochromatic light. In similar way, this formula is also applicable for rectangular apertures of telescope. This formula is also applicable for rectangular apertures of objective of telescope. But for circular apertures, this formula is written as 1.22 lambda upon a. This is the formula for limit of resolutions for objectives having circular aperture. These are the formula for limit of resolution. But in example, of any entrance stage, question is asked about resolving power. Therefore, resolving power of microscope is nothing but the reciprocal of limit of resolution. Therefore, resolving power is equal to, from this formula, we know that 2 mu sin alpha divided by gamma. This is the formula for resolving power of microscope. If the objects are self-limited, then put only mu is equal to 1. But if the objects are externally limited, then write down the value of mu. This is the formula for resolving power of microscope. In the same way, for telescope also, resolving power is nothing but the reciprocal of limit of resolution. Therefore, resolving power is equal to, from this formula, we can write a divided by 1.22 lambda. This is the formula. These two formulas are very important on the CET as a point of view. In both the formulae, note that resolving power is always inversely proportional to wavelength of monochromatic light. That is, to increase the resolving power of an optical instrument, we have to decrease the wavelength of incident light. This is the basic concept. Here, resolving power is equal to a divided by 1.22 lambda. Here, a is the slit width. These are the basic concepts related to diffraction of light, and I gives the points about the CET example. Last point given in the textbook is, what is the difference the interference of light and diffraction of light? This is the last point. Actually, it gives the summary. This difference we can explain considering the following points. Number one is that result. That is, interference phenomenon is the result of superposition of two waves arising from the two coherent sources. Interference is the result of superposition of two waves from two coherent sources. Here, diffraction phenomena is the result of superposition of waves from different points from the same wavefront. Different points of the same wavefront. This is the basic difference. It is the super phenomenon resulting from the superposition of waves from two current sources. But diffraction is the result from the superposition of waves from the different parts of the same wavefront. Next point is that about intensity. In interference pattern, all bright bands are of equal intensity. In interference pattern, all bright bands are of equal intensity, whereas in diffraction pattern, central bright band, that is the central maximum, has the highest intensity and other bright bands are of decreasing intensity. I have drawn the diffraction pattern for clarity. Number 3, dark band. What is about dark band? In interference pattern, all dark bands are perfectly dark. All dark bands are perfectly dark. But in diffraction pattern, all dark bands are not, but dark bands are not perfectly dark. While drawing the intensity variation curve or diffraction pattern, I told this concept. You draw the secondary minima over the x-axis, not exactly on the x-axis, but some distance from the x-axis. This is the point. Next point is that, last but not point, contrast. In interference pattern, there is a good contrast between bright and dark fringes. But in diffraction pattern, there is a poor contrast between dark and bright fringes. Because here bright is bright, but dark is not perfect dark. Therefore, there is a poor contrast between the bright and dark fringes. And last point is about width, that is fringe width. In interference pattern, fringe width is same throughout, that is distance between any two successive bright or any two successive dark bands is always constant. But in diffraction pattern, fringe width is not same, it is of unequal width, because we have written the formula for central maximum. W is equal to twice lambda d upon a, and for secondary minima lambda d upon a. Therefore, in diffraction pattern, the width of central maxima is different from the width of secondary maxima. These are the important points. This is the synopsis, this is the summary which I have given for the students who are facing the CET exam. Only one formula I have forgotten to give, that is relation between path difference and phase difference. Actually, I have to give this formula in the previous period, but path difference is equal to lambda divided by tau square into phase difference, or phase difference is equal to tau square into lambda into r difference, on this formula also there are so many residues asked.